whole life is about sound. You know, it's what makes me tick as a human being. There's sound absolutely everywhere. We have to listen. That's it, really. I want to be open to absolutely everything that comes my way. I mean, this is the most interesting thing with a musician, this sound journey.
Swipe it out first. That's done, that really. we don't need any instrument. Shall we just use the voice?
What's that, 5 seconds?
Because we could work up and down and
absolutely
and across, couldn't we? Well, but you know, the tiniest sounds could be made.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I must say, that is kind of one of the better sounds.
Yeah, they've often said that about my back.
But there's lots of surfaces.
You always imagine a percussion player to strike things. But for me, you know, it's trying to just find the sound way, way, way down in the surface. That is, you have your surface there, but in fact the sound isn't here, it's actually under here. So we want to get under the surface in order to find the sound, rather than just simply striking that surface. hearing is a form of touch. It's something that's so hard to describe because in a way, you know, something that comes, sound that comes to you, you know, you can feel as though you can literally sort of almost reach out to that sound and feel that sound. I was born in the northeast of Scotland on the farm that my father had. When I was at primary school, there was the realization that I was just becoming a little bit slow in reacting to conversations and also missing things out in homework and things like that. But of course, when you're 8 years old, you don't think you're becoming deaf or anything like that. You just think, oh, something's not quite right, and you adapt accordingly. Meanwhile, I had been playing the piano. I started piano from the age of 8 and absolutely loved that. But as the years rolled by, and by the time I reached the age of 11, you know, I was dependent on hearing aids. And when I was about to go to secondary school, the audiologist said, right, you know, she is deaf. She's, you know, she needs these hearing aids and she's not going to be able to play music. She's not going to be able to do this or to do that. And she's going to have to go to a school for the deaf. So it was just so strange that, you know, 30 minutes before walking through the door, I could do whatever I wanted to do. But then 30 minutes later, apparently, the medical profession tells you that you can't do something. And of course, my parents were extremely concerned. And my father just said, look, you know, there is absolutely no difference in how, you know, in what she does, what she wants to do, hearing or not, she will do what she wants to do. I did carry on at a mainstream school.
So introduction, remember, is the title.
I mean, I had great friends and very good teachers too, you know. They wore a little microphone and then I would receive their sound through my hearing aids.
Then at the end of the play, because remember, you're going to have to show how the relationships change.
They had a very strong music department and I was quite eager to find something else to go alongside my piano playing. I thought, well, percussion kind of looks interesting. Maybe I'll try that. Okay, you go on this side. You go on this side because you're right-handed. So just very gently, nothing has to be loud at all. But just the process of coming against the drum and moving away. So it's just like hauling the sound out of the drum. Just try it. Yeah, we'll do, just give it a go. There we go. And just feel the body come against the drum and move out. It's like sort of body movement and sound at the same time. Great, yeah, no, it's great. Because interestingly, you know, even if we strike the drum so soft from the side, we actually see the skin move.
You try.
This time, if we put our hand on the actual shell and take note of what you're feeling through the hand, through the arm and we strike the drum. You try. And there it ends. So what was happening?
I could feel it.
Where did you feel it? Can you be more exact?
Going up my arm.
Eventually, I discovered that by taking the hearing aids off, that in fact I'd actually hear less through the ear, but hear more through the body. And so therefore my teacher would play, for example, two hand-tuned timpani. He would tune them to big intervals apart, and I'd place my hand on the wall and he would do the same, and he would strike one drum and he would ask, where are you feeling that particular drum? I can feel that from here and it's going all the way down my hand. And then he would play the other drum. So where are you feeling that? So maybe here and down here, this part. And then gradually he would lessen the interval so that the minutest difference was possible to detect. But it was the beginning of really using the body as some kind of resonating chamber.
When I hit that one in my hand and there, I could feel it covering my whole hand.
Right.
But this one, I can just feel it in the little bit.
Only a wee bit, yeah. We can feel this. We've got our hand on the drum. We strike it. We can see. We can feel. We've had the process of striking it. Meanwhile, we're hearing this sound because we're feeling this sound far longer than an audience member. Do you see what I mean? So, in fact, we're hearing more. So if you take your hearing aids off and then also, If you want to then put them back in and just to...
No, I feel it.
You'll feel it? No problem. Okay.
Whenever you're ready with a question, I'll have a go at repeating it.
Okay. Hi, Evelyn. Can you tell our readers, what is your favourite instrument?
The snare drum is my favourite. You know, we're dealing with so many percussion instruments, but that one is a challenge, both physically and musically. And of course, there are so many different styles of playing the snare drum, such as the Swiss style and the Irish, American, of course, the Scottish style.
Great. So now, why do you play in your bare feet?
You do feel a wee bit more connected to the sound. There's no question about that.
You can lip read and you have some of your hearing left, but still, how can a profoundly deaf person become a musician?
If someone asks me, oh, well, how'd you hear that? Then I simply say, I really don't know, but I just basically hear that through my body, through opening myself up. How do you hear that? Oh, well, I hear it through the ears. You know, well, what do you mean through the ears? What are you actually hearing? So when you try to bounce the question back to a so-called hearing person, then they simply do not know how to answer these questions. So therefore, why should I be put in that position? That is just slightly upsetting.
It's
just a very thin sound. So you're the kind of heavy.
Oh, okay. You play?
Well, I don't know. We'll see.
Okay. で生きるっていうのがライフっていうことなんですけどもね、その息をするっていうことなんですよね。要は息をっていう、でその息を練るトレーニングをやっぱり しないと、そのもともとその畑仕事だとか激しいこの田んぼを植えたりとかそういうことの農耕民族の上に日本の芸能っていうのが成り立っていて、僕たちがそういうことをしていないので、そういうその何ですかね、足腰を鍛えるだとか、あとその生きるっていう、その息を練るっていう訓練もその走るっていうことにあると思います。
らく名古屋です。14番線に到着、お出口は右側です。
中央線、関西線と名鉄線、近鉄線はこの一方です。
こんな方ももちろん行っております。さあ、いらっしゃいませ。
ADSL YahooBB の ADSL に入りますと、話題の IT 電話 BB 本。
ただ、さあ、この間僕のうちの地元の川越で10本売ってただけ。さあ、1本10円して
どうしますか。今ご注意ください。ゲートが閉じます。ご注意ください。
I feel absolutely secure when I'm performing, but in everyday life, sometimes just a little imbalance happens. I think it's what's coming through the ear.That actually affects me. This kind of cacophony that sometimes comes all of a sudden, or sometimes it's just sort of buzzing around there. Silence is probably one of the loudest sounds and heaviest sounds that you're ever likely to experience. At the end of the day, we still know that within everything that we see, the sound, I mean, we know that. We just don't have that sensitivity to hear what is going on around us.The opposite of sound definitely isn't silence. I don't even know if there is such a thing. Well, there must be an opposite, actually, but I wonder whether it's something that is more static. It's the closest thing I can imagine to death. To return to where I was brought up after quite a long time just conjures all these very innocent and, I have to say, lovely memories.
Looking
oh,
there.
I do, don't I? And I'm mining that blouse and pullover and
something 89.
This is Dad.
What kind of music did you play?
Well, it was Scottish, like Scottish traditional music.
My dad stopped playing once I and my brothers were born. Why this was the case, I've absolutely no idea. The only time he did was during Christmas Eve. That was the time when he would bring the accordion out. And I'd always ask him to play this thing, to play it. And then I would want to have a go. And of course, there's this great big machine buried me practically. Certainly I was Daddy's girl, and I was very fond of my father. It's difficult to describe something like that, but it's just one of those things that this sort of silent energy or chemistry or whatever comes to the fore, and it's one of those things that you, in a way, want to keep quite secret. And certainly that hasn't disappeared to this day, you know, even although, you know, it's been several years since Dad died, that feeling is definitely still there, and he's definitely a source of inspiration for me. For a while, I felt as though I was doing everything for him. It was as though I was carrying Dad's life as well. To leave home, I felt I needed certain things, you know, homemade jam or something like that. And even now, that's definitely the case, but it's more the feeling of having Dad inside that's important.
Thank you.
part of the curiosity is, well, what is it that you know, makes you really be you? You know, what is it that you just love? And my role on this planet is to bring the power of sound. Everything will be let go in the same way that all your music will disappear. But yet, no sound is lost. They live on, but what happens to them, I actually don't know. It's the equivalent of a life. Being a musician, being a dancer, being an artist, you know, is all about the sense of touch, really. The form of communication is about touch. And I don't literally mean that kind of thing. I mean, touch is just something that, a little bit like hearing, it's just so vast, you know. We need all our senses for the others to function. We just do. And, you know, to take away the eye, it's not a big deal. To take away the ear, it's not a big deal. All the other senses will become that particular sense that you've lost. You know, this is what the mysterious sixth sense is about. You know, it creates a type of sense that, you know, we never knew existed until one or the other disappears. You know, in the same way that if suddenly I couldn't function as an actual percussion player, I'd never ever stop being a musician just because I couldn't communicate through the percussion instruments. You know, I'd always be a musician because that's something that is so internal and no one can take that away. You know, no one. We need to eat and we need to sleep and we need music. I mean, it's always happening within yourselves. You know, if you think of a piece of music, we have all the different notes there, different rhythms, dynamics, and so on, all, you know, within that one piece of music. And it's like, you know, the world. I mean, here we are. We've got all these human beings, you know, of all different sorts, all different dynamics, different ages, different accents, one thing or another. You know, it's just imagine them on a page, you know, of music. Imagine them, human beings, being the dots on the page. And it really can be quite amazing to be part of that. And then you understand, wow, we are the sound.
Thank you.